And now, here's Armstrong and Getty.
Ross Douthat goes through the various things that have happened. First is the decision by Twitter to attempt to shut down the circulation of the New York Post story, which looked bad when it was made, but looks even worse now that we have more of a backstory and more evidence in view. At this point, we can posit with some certainty that the Post story was not some sort of sweeping Russian disinformation plot, but a more normal example of late-dropping opposition research filtered through partisan lens, weaving genuine facts into a contestable conclusion. It was, in other words, analogous to all kinds of contested anti-Trump stories that various media outlets have run with across the last four crazy years.
Are running today.
From the publicity around the Steele dossier's rumors to the tales of Michael Cohen's supposed Prague rendezvous and all the other different things.
Right.
In none of these cases did social media minders step in to protect the public from possible fake news. As Matt Taibbi and other gadfly press critics have pointed out, it's hard to come up with any reasonable social media rule that would justify the suppression of the Post story that couldn't just as easily be applied to all the pieces of conspiratorial Trump-Russia reportage that didn't pan out, or the Julie Swetnick allegations against Brett Kavanaugh, or various scoops based on technically illegal leaks. That capriciousness is a bad sign for the project of harnessing social media giants to filter out disinformation. It suggests that any filter would inevitably feel partisan, partial, and obviously reverse engineered. That is, you come up with your policy after the story.
Right.
Which is really annoying.
Right. Yeah.
And he goes on to say that this gives the rest of the media arguably more influence over the non-Fox news-watching portion of the public than in recent past. This means institutions like the New York Times or the Washington Post have a different kind of power than they did 30 years ago, but they have power all the same, including the power to contain almost any story that initially circulates on the right and to shape the way the non-right-wing portions of the country receive it. And that is so true.
Well, and what's so strange about our siloed media consumption is you can count on the majority of Americans not hearing a word about it while you massage it and think about how you want to cover it.
Yeah.
It used to be, can you imagine a newsroom saying, huge story, but let's wait a week on it. I mean, that's just not the way they work.
This, in turn, makes it reasonable for conservatives to fear the concentric circles of tech and media power. The possibility that social media censorship carried out neutrally, in quotes, by companies overwhelmingly staffed by liberals will expand its reach with the vocal support of an increasingly consolidated and liberal group of mainstream media gatekeepers.
Yes, would be the answer to that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
And then a little more as he gets into how this is a real story that they should be covering. Joe Biden, Hunter Biden, and is there any dirty dealing going on that? But I'll hit that after the break.
One of the evil tech companies on the Hill this morning is Google. What happens if you Google the name of a left-wing group? What sort of results do you get? Now let's try it for a right-wing group. We will compare and contrast in moments.
Interesting.
And at Facebook, we often have to balance competing equities. Sometimes the best approach from a safety or security perspective isn't the best for privacy or free expression. So we work with experts across society to strike the right balance. We don't always get it right, but we try to be fair and consistent. The reality is that people have very different ideas and views about where the lines should be. Democrats often say that we don't remove enough content, and Republicans often say we remove too much. I expect that we'll hear some of those criticisms today. And the fact that both sides criticize us doesn't mean that we're getting this right, but it does mean that there are real disagreements about where the limits of online speech should be.
There you go. Mark Zuckerberg getting a grilling. You can't excuse not running the New York Post story.
Crushing it, squashing it.
You can't excuse that.
Nope. That is just stunning. Although it's even more stunning is your revelation earlier that the serious people involved in the study were sharing it with the Wall Street Journal, who was about to break it when Rudy Giuliani interjected himself into the thing and turned it into a bit of a clown show.
You don't know what you're talking about, idiot.
Thanks to Randy for sending this along. He Googled a couple of different organizations using, he literally Googled it. He didn't search it up. Don't use Google. It's evil. Although their search results are pretty effective, honestly. But he Googled Antifa. It's a political protest movement comprising autonomous groups affiliated by their militant opposition to fascism and other forms of extreme right-wing ideology. Again, Antifa is a political protest movement comprising autonomous groups affiliated by their militant opposition to fascism and other forms of extreme right-wing ideology. Thanks, Google. They're not Marxists. They're not violent. Any of that. Let's Google.
That's the Oxford definition of it.
Let's Google the Proud Boys. The Proud Boys is a far-right and neo-fascist, male-only organization that promotes and engages in political violence in the United States and Canada. There you have it. One is far-right and violent. The other is a protest movement opposed to fascism, including the fascism of the Constitution, the fascism of the police, for instance, in Portland, the fascism of the Declaration of Independence, the fascism of the court system, of the schools, the fascism of your neighborhood. There you have it. Thanks, Google.
Google it.
I did.